Hello, everybody. This is the second lecture in biological anthropology, and this is probably the most interesting of the different topics. This is primatology. This is basically when biological anthropologists study non-human primates. Okay. Real quickly, let me go over some dates. You're gonna hear me say this in each lecture. Reflection 5 is now due on Saturday, just because I delayed this posting by too long. And then the final exam will be available from Thursday to Monday, and the extra credit will be due on Tuesday. Okay. If you have any questions, just shoot me an email and I'll be sure to answer you. All right. So anthropology is the study of humanity. Why is the study of non-human primates important, right? So, I mean, the answer here is pretty obvious. It's because primates are related to us. And the more we learn about primates, the more we learn about us as humans, right? And it's important enough to be like its own field in anthropology. If you guys have heard of Jane Goodall, if you guys have ever seen a monkey documentary, like, you know, in high school or middle school or anything really relatively recently, and there's a lady there. That lady is Jane Goodall, and she's a biological anthropologist. Okay. All right. So chapter objectives. The objectives here is to introduce non-human primates, explore the richness and variety of non-human primate ways of life, and examine the evolution of non-human primates, discuss how the study of non-human primate behavior and evolution informs our understanding of what it means to be human. Okay. Sorry. Okay, so let's go into it. So let me go to the next one first. So study non-human primates, right? So primatologists achieve insights into human evolution through comparisons to other primate species. We just went over that. Researchers must guard against anthropomorphism or the imposition of human characteristics on non-human animals. So there is this weird misconception that like anything that's biological is like unbiased. That is very not true. A lot of things that are biological are very biased, in fact. And more importantly, though, when you think about, monkeys in general, think about how you view monkeys, right? Or how we view monkeys in America, let's just say, right? Like, what do you think about them? Okay. So you just think about some of the main characters and then the depictions of primates in America, right? So Big One, Planet of the Apes, Curious George, Mojo Jojo from Powderpuff Girls, Donkey Kong, you know? So there's a few things, right, that come with these images, right? Especially Planet of the Apes and Curious George, and even Mojo Jojo, really intelligence is really emphasized, right? And more importantly, throughout all these different kind of themes of monkeys, like, they're very similar to human beings, okay? And so the problem is that we anthropomorphize, or we place human values onto these animals, right, when they're not. So, for example, what do I mean by that? I mean, okay, if you're doing an experiment on a monkey, do you think that we're treating them the same way we do experiments on mice or cockroaches? Definitely not. When we're doing experiments on monkeys, what are we usually testing? We're usually testing how, like, intelligent they are. We're testing, like, how, you know, their physical capabilities, you know, their similarities to us as families or whatever. What do you think we're doing research on for cockroaches? We're literally researching how to kill them at all times, right? So when we talk about anthropomorphism, we're talking about those types of biases when we're studying animals, right? We purposefully, because we watched Curious George when we were growing up, because we watched, you know, Planet of the Apes, we are putting human characteristics on animals when they don't, or they, when they don't really exist. Right. Also, too, just to add on to the overall like theme, it's like, again, you know, just because it's biological, just because it's hard science, doesn't mean that it's not bias. There's been tons of research that demonstrate, especially of primates, that demonstrate like homosexual behavior, specifically among chimpanzees. But guess what? That never gets published in the paper. Why? Because most of the funding for this type of research comes from conservative Christian organizations. So
they're not going to publish it, obviously, right? And that's really important because, again, it just goes to show that when we're doing research, there's no such thing as unbiased. It's always biased. Okay. Finally, taxonomies or classification schemes have been created to by primatologists to make sense of primate diversity. All right. So how do biologists classify primates? Taxonomists classify organisms into groups, arrangement, hierarchy, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. Primates are a class in the system. Species are assigned a Latin name consisting of genus and species, such as Homo sapiens or modern humans, right? So this is an order, right? Kingdom is the biggest thing, and species is the most specific thing. Primates are a class, so they're in the middle, but toward the big side. And then, so that includes, for example, you know, humans, chimpanzees, orangutans, gorillas, apes, whatever, right? That's all within this class. So it's a pretty big class. All right. So approaches to primate taxonomies. This is kind of important. Traditional taxonomies, which meaning old traditional ways of grouping primates, compared phenotypes and adaptations. Phenotypes are basically visible traits and adaptations, right? They have this type of fur, they have this type of fingers, they have this type of eyes, whatever. They also looked at morphology or the shape and size of organisms to classify them, okay? Primates with similar levels of complexity in similar environments were also grouped in the same evolutionary grade. So we're looking at the similarities that they're trying to base this off of is like, okay, how they look, what do they do, what size are they? Are they of the same like intellectual level? And the last thing is, do they live in a similar environment, right? So it could be in the forest, on the mountains, whatever, okay? Now, traditional taxonomies recognize four evolutionary grades: prosimians, anthropoids, hominoids, and hominids. Apes are then further subdivided into lesser apes and great apes, okay? Now, cladistic taxonomies, which is a more modern form of grouping these bad boys together, of primates, group animals with shared and derived features. It's very important. Shared and derived features represent homologous evolutionary traits. Homologies represent similarities due to common ancestry. So homologies is very straightforward. How they group them together is based off of, hey, is this trait from the same ancestor? Okay, so for example, if you look at a chimpanzee and you look at humans, you look at our teeth, our fingers, our whatever, right? Is this trait from a common ancestor? If yes, then we group them together. Does that make sense? As opposed to looking at the more physical and kind of more obvious features, we're trying to look at, hey, did this trait come from the same ancestor or not, right? And that's a homology. Now, that being said, though, the difficulty here is deciding what is a homology and what is homoplasy. Homoplasy represents a case of convergent or parallel evolution, which basically means that there's similar physical features that are seen in distinct organisms adapting to similar environments. So basically, they have the same thing, but they're from a different ancestor. The examples that they're provided here are great. So the wings on birds and bats, right? A bird and a bat are not from the same ancestor, even though they both have wings, right? And so you need to see, like, oh, hey, are these wings from the same ancestor? If so, then they're grouped together, and if not, then they're grouped separately. Another great example is squirrels and humans, right? So squirrels, fun fact, they have thumbs, right? Humans also have thumbs. Do we have a common ancestor? No, definitely not, okay? Another example they provide in the textbook is the hydrodynamic body shape in fishes and whales, right? Fishes and whales are not related. They are not related. I believe whales are mammals, so they're actually more related to us than the other fishes, okay? But because they both live in the water, they both develop the same body shape, and we might think that they have a similar ancestor, but they don't, okay? So that's what the cladistic taxonomy is all about. It's grouping animals based off of derived and shared features. All right, so let's talk about some primate evolution. Primates are flexible, resilient, and creative. I'm going to talk about these after the videos. Primates share at least six evolutionary trends: increasing brain size relative to body size and increasing brain complexity, decreasing facial projection and reliance on the sense of smell, increasing dependence on sight, decreasing the number of teeth, increasing period of infant dependence, and greater dependence on learned behavior. All right, so let's take a quick look at these videos. If I don't play both these videos right here, it means I had to cut it out because YouTube is like what's it called? What's it called? The you know, the licensing and trademarking and stuff. So if you only see one video, that means you need to watch the other one on your own. Don't worry, they're really quick. But yeah, we'll see how much they hate me. All right, play this. Let me silence myself.
Binge eating isn't great for their teeth, but these clever monkeys have come up with the most remarkable solution. And it involves stealing human hair. They use it to dental floss. There's a few theories as to why they floss their teeth. One is because it keeps their teeth clean. Another is that they get extra bits of food. But it could also be that their high sugar diet irritates their gums. It takes great dexterity and initiative to work out how to floss. But some get the hang of it quicker than others. Humans only invented dental floss 200 years ago, and macaques are the only other animal in the world to do this. It's complex problem solving that shows our monkey cousins really aren't that far behind.
Okay, so again, if you did not see those videos, it means you might need to, what's it called? You might need to watch them on your own. But they're only like 2.5 minutes, so they should be pretty quick. Let's go back. So let's talk about these traits, right? So this is primate evolution. So this is evolution of primates overall, like includes humans, includes chimpanzees, right? Everybody. Primates are flexible, resilient, and creative. So flexible is exactly what it sounds like, right? If you look at primates, we're very flexible in terms of like where we live. We're very flexible in terms of what we eat. We're very flexible in terms of how we live. If you look at primates all across the world, some of us live in mountains. Humans live everywhere, right? But we live in forests. We live in savannas. We live in a lot of places, right? So primates are very flexible. If you take like, for example, obviously, if you take a fish and you take it to some other sea or something, they're going to die very quickly. If you take a lion outside of its natural environment, they die very quickly, so on and so forth, right? Primates are very flexible. Primates are also very resilient. And what does resilient mean? It means that they can deal with a lot of hardship in terms of bouncing back, right? So starvation, famine, death, like whatever environmental pressures. Primates can deal with that and bounce back a lot more than other types of animals. Okay. Creative. This is a big one. Creative, macaques, right? With, in Thailand. Okay. They're very, very creative, right? Like basically learning to like floss your teeth is not some easy task, right? I mean, it's easy for us because we kind of know how to do it already. But if you really think about, you know, like other animals and how difficult it is, it's not as easy as you think. To use that as a solution is pretty interesting. Not to mention the colobus monkeys that use coal to basically as an antidote or potion to or medicine to relieve the stomach pains from eating the mango and the cashew leaves. It's pretty creative, right? And also some of the context, I don't, they used to be on YouTube, it used to be on Netflix, so I used to be able to show it more of it, but now it's not, so I can't. But the first video with the macaques with the flossing of the teeth, that's a very interesting event because they live harmoniously with the people. Like, think about how many wild animals live in harmony with people, right? And that goes to the flexible and resilient thing. But also that day in particular is a feast day to honor the monkeys. And so they just lay out like all this food. And when I say food, I don't just mean like whole food. I mean like Cheez-Its and stuff. Like they have like chips and stuff and the monkeys are able to eat and kind of enjoy themselves. So it just goes to show again that creativity, it just goes to show that they really represent these three traits really well: flexible, resilient, and creative. Okay. Now let's talk about the evolutionary trends, right? Brain size, brain complexity. Straightforward, they're mad smart, right? We as a primate, as a class, we just got really smart over time. Decreasing facial projection and reliance on the sense of smell. We're actually going to probably talk about this later on in the lecture, but basically, yeah, we're talking about it later on in the lecture, so don't worry about this. Increased dependence of sight, those two are related. Decreasing number of teeth, that is probably diet related, but nothing here. But okay, let's talk about the last two. Increased period infant dependence. So this is very true. So even wild like primates, the amount of time that a baby must rely on its mother or basically cannot fend for itself is really long. If you look at other animals like sharks or even cats or dogs or whatever, they're able to get in and out. I mean, they're able to take care of themselves very quickly, right? And the greater dependence on learned behavior. We saw that especially with the macaques and the colobus monkeys where they learned how to use the hair to floss, right? Obviously, the younger ones were not as good at it and the older ones are better. And the colobus monkeys, they probably learned from each other like that coal can relieve some of the stomach pains of eating those leaves, right? Yeah. Okay, cool. So very good. Let's move on. So are there patterns in primate evolution? Primates share unique prehensile morphology. Proposable thumbs with great big toes, nails rather than claws on at least some fingers or toes, pads and tips of fingers, toes with many nerve endings, dermal ridges, friction skin on toes, fingers, soles, palms, and underside of the prehensile tails. This is just some things in common that we have as a whole in terms of evolution. All right, now, this is interesting. So, model of primate evolution. These are basically different theories as to why we evolved the way we did. The first one is arboreal theory, which is primates represent an adaptation to living in trees, right? And this has more to do with this slide, right? Where we develop certain thumbs and certain types of skin so we can hang and swing easier. A visual predation hypothesis. And this has to do with the reliance on sight and the decreasing reliance on smell. So basically, if we evolved to eat insects, right? I need you, it sounds crazy, but have you ever tried to smell an insect? No, it's very difficult to smell an insect. So that's why we developed a bigger dependence on our vision, right? Because we can see insects, we can't smell them, right? And you look at also on the spectrum of animals, our vision is quite good and our smell is actually quite bad compared to a lot of other animals. Mixed dye hypothesis. This has to do with the number of teeth. Okay. Primates evolved because they switch from eating insects to having to eat plants. Okay. That's pretty straightforward. All right. Primate evolution during the Cenozoic, Paleocene epoch, 55 to 54 million years ago, or the ends of primates, Eocene epoch, 54 to 38 million years ago. Primates are divided into adipids and omnimids. Adipids look like living lemurs but lack a dental comb. Omnimids look like living tarsiers. Anthropoidians appear and are ancestral later monkeys, apes, and humans. Oligocene epoch, 38 to 33 million years ago. Anthropoidian fossils are divided into parapithecids and propleopithecids. Parapithecids may be ancestral to New World monkeys, and propleopithecids may be ancestral to all later older monkeys, apes, and humans. The earliest hominoid or ape fossils date back to like Oligocene. Miocene epoch, 23 to 5 million years ago, hominoid diversity decreased during the middle of the Miocene. Old world monkeys become very successful during the late Miocene. Chimpanzees, gorillas, and humans share a common ancestor in the late Miocene. Hominins, a bipedal hominoid, appear during the late Miocene. Great. So, full circle, anthropology is a study of humanity. Why is the study of non-human primates important? It's very straightforward. The more we know about non-human primates, the more we understand about our own evolution. And as you'll see in the next lecture, actually, it's kind of important because of how similar we are, but also how related we are in each other's evolution. Okay. Again, if you have any questions, just shoot me an email at raymond.fong@kbcc.cuny.edu.